Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for Ham Nation is provided by Cachefly at CACHEFLY.com.
This episode of Ham Nation is brought to you by Netflix. Watch thousands of TV episodes and movies on your PC, your Mac, your iPod, your iPhone, and TV instantly. All streamed directly to you, saving you time, money, and hassle. And for your free 30-day trial, go to netflix.com/TWIT.
This is Ham Nation, episode number 20, recorded October 4th, 2011, MFJ Factory Tour. Internet? We don't need no stinking internet. We've got the ionosphere, and Ham Nation is on the air. Wait, I'm being told we do need the internet for Ham Nation to be on the air. So never mind. Cancel the don't need no stinking internet. We'll still have an internet. Good evening, everybody. I am Gary Pearce, KN4AQ. Along with Gordon West, WB6NOA. Hello, Gordon. Are you copying out there on the West Coast?
We are copying you loud and clear, Gary. Hi to everyone. Hi to the chat room. And we've got answers, and you've got great questions. Go ahead, Gare.
And George Thomas, W5JDX, over in Mississippi. We have all corners of the country covered, George.
Yeah, good to see everyone tonight. And I feel a little underdressed after seeing Gordo there.
Well, I have my purple twit-colored T-shirt on once again, so I think I'm doing okay. Gordon, you look like you're all set to go to an ARRL convention.
Well, you know, we are. In fact, we're going to see Leo next week up at Santa Clara, which is near San Francisco on the west side of the U.S. And Leo is going to draw so much attention to ham radio that we can't wait for the Pacificon convention a weekend after next. We'll be there, and so will Leo and a whole bunch of other hams.
Are you going to be doing a forum there at Pacificon?
I believe I am on tropospheric ducting, as well as I'm the Saturday morning. Good morning. And we've got some exciting audio that we're going to play, hair-raising audio on that Saturday morning to get everybody reared up and ready to roll.
I've seen some of your forums at Dayton. And, you know, hams at forums, the hams presenting forums can be a little dull. I mean, we're all interested in the subject matter, and it's all, you know, it's exciting because it's exciting subject matter. But you come bounding out, and just light up the room. It's a fascinating thing to see. So if you guys out there on the West Coast are going to Pacificon, you want to make sure that you see Gordon's forum, especially if you haven't had your coffee yet. He will wake you up.
Well. I appreciate that, Gary, but you know, it's two-way. I usually start off with some fun little gag things, and if everybody sits there stone-faced, I'm a washout. So
it's thanks to the
audience that makes it happen.
Yeah, well, every performer has that, but they don't. I've never seen a bad audience for you. You light them up. Okay, you got a shirt on. You claim it's pink, not white, and there's purple in your tie. I want to know if you're wearing shorts down there below camera.
We actually have rain. Hannah and Julian did a rain dance, so it's pouring rain outside. So I do have long pants on. In fact, I'll continue to wear the long pants even when we do our 20 and 40 meter, as well as we've got IRLP, we have Echo Link, we have D-Star. We're going to be on the air in about 45 minutes from now talking live. So I promise I'll continue to wear the long pants.
I don't think anyone has ever seen you wearing long pants. Can you stand up a little bit so we can see that? Because I've only seen you wearing shorts.
See, here we go. There they are. Long pants.
And the shirt isn't even tucked.
There we go.
I can't stand up because I'm not wearing no pants. I'm wearing sweatpants. So I'm doing the newscaster thing where it looks nice from the waist up, and then below that, you don't get to see. Let's see, our rundown. I really should have this better prepared. Do we have some email? Has anyone been writing to us? Bob claims people write to us all the time.
We have email, and one comes from JN6IGI, also from Paul, 2ECHO0KDM. I've never heard that kind of call sign. That's a beginner call sign in the UK. And KC6UNY, and they all figured out that on my brain thumper, that the reason we could only get down 2-to-1 at resonance was because of the counterpoise, or the ground plane was not large enough, or was not quite what the antenna analyzer was looking for. So they all said it was probably like 25 ohms impedance, and that's why the 2-to-1 SWR. So my question is, but why? And the answer is, a ground plane with a radials going straight out would be about 30 ohms. Going down at a 45-degree angle would be about 50 ohms. And a ground plane on a vehicle that went straight down, as many do, might be 80 or 90 ohms. So it's no wonder on a vehicle that's not necessarily 45 degrees down on the ground why we don't have an SWR that is 1-to-1. So, yep, it's the ground. And I'm happy to say our guests at MFJ come up with a great analyzer to tell what's going on. And also, we can, with the MFJ, as well as other antenna matching little inductance or capacitance shunt devices, be able to bring that SWR down to 1-to-1 by bringing the feed point up to 50 ohms. So congratulations, a lot of winners on last week's Brain Thumper.
And for people who were not watching last week or haven't downloaded it and watched it, you were talking about mobile antennas. And the antenna that you were doing your example of was an outbacker. But I think you said that counts for every antenna, every mobile antenna.
Yeah, it sure does.
Yeah, a vehicle, not quite enough metal in it, unless maybe you're driving a semi.
Right. And that antenna exactly at a spot where all the metal around it comes down at a 45-degree angle to bring that feed point up to 50. So thank goodness for a little matching impedance devices that go right there at the feed point.
Well, I've been using Tar Heel screwdriver antennas for some time. And before that, I was using an Outbacker. And I forget which one, could have been either one, in the instructions said that if your SWR on the mobile antenna is 2-to-1 or better, that's fine. 1.1-to-1, not necessary. 1.5-to-1, nice, but still not necessary. Anything below 2-to-1 would be pretty much good enough. And that's what I see. A few bands approach 2-to-1, but most of them are a little bit better than that. So and my mobile antenna is mounted on the left rear corner of a Toyota RAV4, a little SUV. So not a great ground plane, but it seems to work pretty well. I also understand, we ought to do a mobile show sometime. I'm sure we can come up with some mobile experts that have more expertise than you and I do. That you want a really good ground strap and you want it to be short. And you don't want the antenna mounted way up high. You want the base of the antenna to be low and a very short, a foot or less ground strap to your bonding to the car. So those are the things that I understand. I don't understand why, but that's what I've been told. George, now you were saying that you see that problem in your car. Is that making sense to you?
Yeah, it's not a 2-to-1. I'm probably closer to 1.7-to-1 on mine, and that makes sense. I had thought it was going to be the feed point impedance. I just had not calculated in. It was because of the ground plane.
All right. So probably a lot of folks operating mobile out there. Anybody, let's see, what are they saying down in the chat room? Jeff is forwarding me some pertinent comments. Back when you were checking out your britches there, somebody said that we had gone R-rated. So, but I don't think so. You looked fine to me. Let's see, what do we have next? So that's the stumper, and that's the email. Our next item is Newsline. Time to find out what's going on out there in the world of ham radio. And for that, we head to, I think it's still Don Wilbanks, and our Newsline report. And so, Alex, if you got it all queued up, and now the news.
From the Amateur Radio Newsline, these are the Ham Nation headlines for October 4th, 2011. The FCC and FEMA have issued guidelines on what steps citizens should take before, during, and after a local disaster. But no personal form of two-way radio is included. Among the simple steps suggested by the two agencies is to keep charged batteries and car phone chargers available for backup power for your cell phone. Keep at least one non-cordless wireline phone in your home because in most cases it will work even if you lose power. Also, have a battery-powered radio or television receiver available along with some spare batteries. The tips do note that broadcasters are a strong source of time-critical information, but also remind you that citizens should avoid putting strain on easily overburdened wireless service networks by watching streaming broadcasts and other high-bandwidth services. Get ready for Scouting's Jamboree on the Air. This year's JOTA takes place October 15th and 16th. This international event is the largest scouting event in the world. Last year, just over 700,000 scouts participated in the event from nearly 6,000 stations around the globe. Many of the American stations will be setting up at weekend camporees or jamborees with a big opportunity to introduce scouts to the fun of talking on the radio, using a computer for PSK activity, or even talking to an astronaut. CQ Communications will launch multi-platform digital editions of all of its magazine titles before the end of 2011. These titles include CQ Magazine, CQ VHF, Popular Communications, and World Radio Online. Editorial Director Rich Moses in W2VU says the digital editions will supplement, not replace, current print editions and will feature enhancements not possible in the print medium. Versions will be available for a variety of online and mobile platforms, including PC, Mac, iPhone, iPad, Android 2.0, and more. For details on these stories and more, point your web browser to www.arnewsline.org. I'm Don Wilbanks, AE5DW. Now back to Ham Nation.
Thank you, Don. And once again, I'll remind everybody that Newsline's full edition, which runs about 40 minutes or so, available on many repeaters across the country. So tune into a local repeater near you. You mostly played over the weekend, some off into the week. If a local repeater near you doesn't play it, you can download it from their website. So very valuable service. Gordon, you've got the Pacificon coming up. Back at Labor Day, I attended the Shelby Hamfest. Shelby is another large regional hamfest, and it's held on the Labor Day weekend. It's well, these days it's near Shelby, North Carolina. It used to be in Shelby, and they had kind of a dispute with the fairgrounds where it had been held. And eventually the club that runs the hamfest just said, well, you guys want whatever it is you want's too much, we'll find a better place. And they moved. So the Shelby Hamfest is now in Dallas, North Carolina. Dallas is just a little crossroads community. It's not like Dallas, Texas. Shelby has been a really large regional hamfest. And Gordon, and George, I don't know about the hamfests near you. I suspect the same thing happened. All the hamfests that I know about reached a really big peak in the late 90s, right about 2000, about the same time ham radio's population was really peaking. And then throughout the 2000s, they had a nearly precipitous fall off. The attendance at Hamfest just kind of went downhill. That happened to our local Hamfest. It happened at Dayton. You know, Dayton was in the 30,000 range, 30,000 plus, and they dropped more than 10,000 over the subsequent few years. Same thing has happened at Shelby. Shelby had been pretty huge, probably in the 7,000-9,000 category, and has dropped off quite a bit. I've seen a plateau, kind of a bottoming out of that drop-off, and some hamfests are inching their way back up. I don't think anybody's growing like wildfire, but they're inching their way back up. What have you seen out there in the California area, Gordon? Was it a similar story? Gordon, if you turned your sound off, you need to turn it back on. I'm not hearing you. I've lost Gordon's sound. So, George, we'll switch over to you, and while Gordon works on where his sound went, what have you seen in the Midwest?
Well, in the Jackson, Mississippi Hamfest, which is one I attend every year here, it has held over the years. I've been going to it for over 20 years, And I've never really seen a drop-off in it. We don't have as many dealers, new dealers there now. But the flea market continues to grow every year, and we still have some new dealers. But the numbers are staying up and inching back up a little bit again. So really not that big a drop-off here. This is kind of in the middle of the South, and we've always had a pretty good crowd here. So they've been real lucky here at the club.
Okay. Well, as we're going to watch a couple minutes of video that I put together from the Shelby Hamfest. Now, we can't promote every Hamfest in the country because we'd be doing nothing but talking about Hamfests for the whole show. But in the chat room, if you want to toss out some of the larger regional Hamfests coming up in the next 30, 90 days or so, Jeff will scrape them off and I'll do a quick review of them after this little bit of video. But for now, let's head to the Shelby, North Carolina Hamfest and see what was going on there. The Shelby Hamfest is about 55 years old now. The exhibitors are kind of crammed into this one small building. And unfortunately, this year, the air conditioning didn't work, so we were all pretty toasty. They used to get all the big manufacturers, Icom, Kenwood, Yaesu. This year, Yaesu and Flex were the only major manufacturers there, and MFJ always comes with a big display. I'm not sure who the rigger is, somebody who is exploring their dream. Lots of dealers, plenty of opportunity to pick up new equipment. And they also fill up the hallways of this little building. Vendors are crammed in pretty much every place, every square inch available, including me and my lovely wife, Cindy. They have a few forums, some small forum rooms. The flea market is all outdoors, and it's very spread out. The Hamfest has moved from a fairgrounds where things were a bit more concentrated, but they had a dispute with that fairgrounds a few years ago, so they've moved to a new location and ended up a lot more spread out. The shade trees are prime spots. They get snapped up early. Leo, you'll be interested in this. Broadcast equipment is fairly common at Hamfests. This is the very first console I ever used at a radio station, the Gates Yard. This, for a lot of people, is what hamfesting is all about.
Get a treasure?
My wife and I both use this as our novice transmitter. We have one just like this. So we got to have one now. Just missing a meter.
Yeah, I was going to say, it looks a little rough.
I've seen them rougher.
And you can fix it?
Oh, yeah. In the 50s, they built things to last.
RVing is popular among hams, and this Hamfest attracts a pretty good-sized RV area. Since it's so spread out, they rent, actually, golf carts. You can rent one and drive around the area. And Shelby is a two-day Hamfest. On Sunday, things are a lot quieter. Some manufacturers say that they won't come to a one-day Hamfest. They'll only come to two-day Hamfests, even if Sunday is pretty empty. And as I said last week at Huntsville, which was a little busier on Sunday, but was still pretty lightly attended, it's a much better opportunity to talk with manufacturers' representatives without feeling rushed for them to get on to the next customer. And, of course, even the flea market is pretty quiet. And here's Mark, KJ4VO, a sales manager from HRO in Atlanta, talking on the IC9100 on D-Star and wrapping up the Hamfest for us.
Shelby Hamfest has been wonderful. 9100 has been a nice little display here. On a lot of people looking at it, and it's sold quite well. So, all right, have a good day. We'll catch you later on tonight. AB4VJ, KJ4VO, Shelby Hamfest.
And a quick look at the Shelby Hamfest. Let's see what folks have been tossing at us from the from the chat room. Okay. First of all, Bailey crew, you're back. We can hear you.
Oh, good. Okay, great.
What was wrong?
I'm not sure, but we too have also suffered a decline in the...
Uh-oh. Disappeared again. A couple of weeks ago, he had a bad spot on his mixer, but that's not what it sounds like right now. And we've all got two microphones pointed at us. I see the microphones back in the... on the table. So, neither one of them is working for Gordon. Let's see. Surveying briefly the chat room. First of all, Bailey Crew is a first-timer watching the Ham Nation. So he's, you know, says, give a shout out to the newbies. Rochester, New York Hamfest is going to be at RIT. I have no idea what RIT is in the upstate Finger Lakes, New York area. You guys, when you put stuff in the chat room, don't be obscure. Don't be vague. Spell it out a little bit. Charlotte Hamfest coming up in March. Nearfest next weekend. I don't know what or where the Nearfest is, but it's next weekend, October 13th and 14th. Belton, Texas, October 22nd. That is my birthday. Perfect time for a Hamfest. Stone Mountain Hamfest. Doesn't say when it is, but it gives the website stonemountainhamfest.com. I think it's down by Atlanta. Happen to know about that one. Nearfest is Deerfield, New Hampshire. Let's see. Drumlin's Hamfest in Newark, New Jersey. Doesn't say when it is. Fort Wayne Hamfest, November 19th and 20th. Hamilton, Ontario, October 15th. And Gordon should get on CW. Oh, the St. Louis Hamfest on Halloween weekend. That sounds like a interesting Hamfest. I wonder if people dress up in costumes for it. And seeing some of the hams at some of the ham fests I go to sort of think that they've already dressed up in costumes. So, well, we'll see. That will be a cool one to go to, though. Gordon, are you back? Test your audio here.
Gordon has left the building.
Gordon has disappeared entirely. He's rebooting, and we should have him back in a couple of minutes. Well, George, it's time to head back to MFJ. Now, last week we met Martin Zhu. What was Martin's call sign again?
K5FLU.
Is he ever on the air? Are you in the repeater range of Martin? I'm not sure how local he is to you. Is he ever on the air? Do you ever hear him?
Well, I'm not within repeater range of him. Of course, I'm within HF range, but I've never talked to him on the air. I think he mostly works CW, but yeah, he's still active.
That would be cool. Now, before he started talking, when we first saw him, everyone saw, obviously, he's Chinese. The chat room went nuts last week when he started to talk because I guess you were expecting a Chinese accent or at least a flat American accent. And when he opened his mouth and had this Southern drawl, everybody was, well, it was like, wait, are we hearing the right guy here? So does he have like an authentic Mississippi accent? I guess he described that he grew up there. So that's, you know, where it came from, but. That's a Mississippi accent.
Oh, yeah, that's a Mississippi Delta accent, and his family's been there for several generations, just like the rest of us. And so he's got a bad case of it, just like me.
Well, yeah, it was a disconnect. Very,
no,
very,
it's real.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Gordon, you're back. Welcome back.
Yep. Well, thank you. Right. And again, we too saw the diminish of all the activity at Hamfest, but now it's coming back, and we think that we're going to pull 4,000 to 5,000 a week from this weekend when Leo is at PacificCon. So we're looking forward to a bigger and better Hamfest.
I hope so. I'd like to see them coming back. It was very sad to see them start to fall off. And this gives me the opportunity to mention a question that came back from the chat room. Somebody wants to know, R. Faust wants to know, if there's a website that lists all Hamfests. And the answer to that is sort of no, but there's a website where you can get most of them. And I have an interesting comment about that. Well, the website is, of course, the ARRL. ARRL website, ARRL.org, has a prominent link where you can find Hamfests listed a variety of ways. You can do searches by state, by section, by all kinds of searches by date, things like that. So you can find most Hamfests, and they list the ones that are ARRL affiliated and the ones that are not. They don't discriminate. A few years ago, I was editing a magazine called the Sarah Repeater Journal, and one of the popular features of the Repeater Journal was a Hamfest listing. We concentrated on the Southeast. The Southeastern Repeater Association is the frequency coordination group here for the Southeast. And so we concentrated on that area. And it was my job, among other things, to dig up references to Hamfests to make this a really good, accurate listing of regional and area Hamfests. What I can tell you from that experience is that some Hamfests go to great lengths to hide their existence, making it very difficult to find that they exist. Their websites were out of date. Links and contacts and phone numbers and emails led no place. So I will have known that a Hamfest exists for several years, but suddenly can't find anything about them. And they may pop up 30 days before the Hamfest and update their website. So if you're wondering why people haven't been coming to your Hamfest, perhaps you should check and see if anybody can find out when and where it is. So my advice. And now, back to you, George, and part two of your program on MFJ. What are we going to learn about tonight?
Well, this is a tour of the MFJ plant in Starkville, Mississippi that I did, I guess it was the same day that I did the interview with Martin. It's a great bunch of guys there. This is Richard Stubbs. He'll be doing the tour of the plant here. We'll get to see all the different assembly lines there and some of the gear actually being built. And my favorite part of the whole tour there is toward the end of this video. And when we come back, I've got a little something I want to give away here. This is a Vectronics comprehensive soldering course kit that is one of the MFJ companies. They have several companies there. And I've had this ever since we built the Crystal Radio, and we finally decided to give it away this week. So we'll tell you how you could win that when we get back from the tour.
All right, let's go.
This is what we really do well, is manufacture ham products. We start with a blank board. This one has actually gotten surface mount, and you'll see that later, more of the technology up front and close and personal. This is our automatic tuner line. This is our newest product line that we have. We range in retail price from $219.95 all the way to $699 on the end. That is a full legal limit automatic tuner. We just came out. It just started gracing the pages of our catalog. And it's a very popular product line for us now, too. So we have devoted a full line to that, whereas when it first started, it was a very few people. Of course, we got high competition there, too. You got LDG competing there, right, and SGC. But some of their products on that end are at $1,200. We're on the low end at $699, but we think our product's better. And these ladies think it's better, too. So what they got, they'll come out here with the blank PC board, and then after it's been surface mount, they'll come out here, they'll hand stuff the boards as she's doing right there, and it'll walk itself down the line. It'll get PC board tested. It'll get run through the wave solder machine, and then it'll get final tested by inline tester on the end. And right here, you also notice, this is a real interesting thing here. Our analyzers are used throughout our testing procedures. Most of the guys that are inline testers, they have an SWR analyzer from MFJ that is used to test the products. Those products are able to do a lot of different things. They can test roller inductors to make sure the contact wheel is making contact on the coil, and so on. So this is he's also got one of our Ameritron amps here to test for power. This is Sam here. He's doing the Mirage VHF UHF amplifiers. Sam is, I think, one of about three people running the entire company on this line. We did take some of the Mirage amps to the Ameritron factory so they could do more of the high volume sales stuff. He does a lot of the commercial, the 220, 440 megahertz amplifiers and the business band. Everything on Mirage is hand stuffed, hand soldered, handmade. I talked to a lot of hams that buy a new house and they don't want to drill a hole in their house, and their wife surely doesn't want them to. So we've came up with the idea where you can shut the window, cut this down to size, and put your coax feed points and all your insulators through here, and then that way you don't drill a hole through your house. Also very popular now is this HF giant watt meter.
Yeah, that's nice.
This is something that the hams can see. Now this is a massive line. It kind of looks like a lot of garbage, but we got so many different products up here. These are all models of the different things they build, and it's a wide array of products. We go from SO2R switch, which is brand new. We're just now finally getting out. That's you switch between two radios and two microphones. We got our conditioner, where you can tailor your voice to go up or down in pitch if I want to go lower. You got your noise-canceling antenna. if you got a power line fence or some other signal that's causing a problem.
That has been something in particular of interest to me. I want to play with one day.
Good, good. Well, you know you can try it out. The other things are the voice key reader, the sound card radio interfaces. Mm-hmm. These are popular for decoding digital data. We also make the voice keyer on this line. This is where you can push a button, CQ, CQ. This is KC5NSZ. You can go cute this Mississippi. You can add in other phrases in here. We also make these for Morse code, the same thing, where a guy's got on his paddle, all he has to do is hit a button, and it'll do the same thing in Morse code. We have single sideband, CW rigs. These were very popular in the 90s, and you know, there used to be a dedicated newsletter to 90 series radios from MFJ. We had the 5-watt transceivers and the 10-watt sideband rigs. Now we've got like a little 2.5-watt. This is a 40-meter transceiver in the palm of your hand.
Wow.
You can take this backpacking, put an antenna on it, get a little key and a paddle, which we sell also, and then you've got a full radio in the palm of your hand, and put it in your backpack and go do your other hobbies like hiking and backpacking. This is another new area for us, the Wi-Fi. There's a finished product there. This is the 15 dBi Yagi. And what we do with this, you can hook this up to your computer and steer it out to Holiday Inn Express. I shouldn't mention any names out there, or wherever, and try to get some bandwidth.
So is this going to work as good as my Cantenna?
You got a Cantenna that does the same thing for Wi-Fi?
Basically, yeah.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
We've been selling a lot of these. This is a 15 dBi, 16, I think it was 16 elements.
Well, it probably is as good as a camera.
Yeah, and it sells for $29.95. The thing is, the cable, which are hard to get, sell for $24.95.
Yeah.
So the cable's almost as much as the antenna. That's the MFJ 259B and the 269. The SWR analyzers, one covers 1.8 to 170. The other one covers 1.8 to 170 plus 415 to 470. We're in process. We're trying to work on one that'll be continuous coverage, which is what everybody wants, and obviously the commercials companies do. And right here is where they stuff all the through-hole parts. You can see there's quite a few still left to go. And what we do is we put them in there, and you can see that the ribbon cable is still loose, and none of these traces have been soldered. We also put tape on the bottom because we're going to run this through the wave solder machine. All these points at that point will be soldered. Now the surface mount components have already been soldered once because they went through an oven and they got soldered in there. Right here we have a coil winder for our roller inductors that we actually build here now. A lot of people don't realize that. We used to buy products from various different companies and then now we took out the middleman, we make them ourselves. The roller inductors, the capacitors for the big tuners, also the coils. These are coils that we used to have to buy from a company, but now we manufacture these in our metal shop. They're actually in a big long tube, and then we cut them down to size. These are used in tank circuits for Ameritron. They're used in antenna designs for like bug catchers and mini screwdrivers. Also, these are used in all these various different sizes of tuners. You can see there's different sizes of coils. So. We will take these out then to the lines and put them in the antenna tuners. They're working on roller inductors. There's that slinky that we were talking about that was made from the coil winder. Miss Annie here does all the roller inductor production and all the capacitor production. Earlier she was working on capacitors. Now she's working on roller inductors. And all of these capacitors are the models that we build right here.
All right, so y'all don't import any of these air variables anymore.
Now, the smaller ones we do.
Okay.
There are some of the little 300-watt tuners are still imported capacitors.
Mm-hmm.
But we go all the way down to, I think this was the 125 picofarad, up to 500 picofarad. I think that's the one for the Ameritron tuner, the antenna tuner for Ameritron ATR-30. And then we make all the roller inductors. And our most expensive roller inductor, most expensive part that we sell and manufacture ourselves is this edge-wound silver-plated roller inductor. This is $95.80 as a part, and we're selling these like crazy to people all over the world that are built. There's still a lot of hams building their own projects.
Well, you can't really find roller inductors just anywhere.
No. And that's another one of Mr. Jew's dreams. He was talking to you about dreams.
Mm-hmm.
He wanted to become a parts house. That's why you see now in our new catalog. We're starting to, we always offered all the parts, but now we are actually showing that we offer them. We got a 300 watt switched inductor antenna tuner. You got a 300 watt roller inductor antenna tuner with the air core rollers that they designed on this end. Then you step up to about an 800 watt PEP there, and then 1500 watts. And then we've got finally our big bad boy on the end. It's 2500 watts continuous carrier antenna tuner. This one's got the silver plated edge wound. This is the model, so this is not looking as pretty as those ones down there. We're going to run power from our 1500 watt amplifier here. This is the AL82 into our 989D. He's got a 1500 watt can dummy load back there with oil, and then also a bird watt meter as usual to calibrate that meter to the standard of the bird. This was actually a unique story. This DSP filter was actually our first surface mount board. And a lot of people wonder why, because DSP is built in every radio there is now, especially the ones up front. But there are a lot of old old radios out there that don't have DSP. So we still sell a lot of these boards. And, we basically have to redesign boards in order to use the surface mount. So that was another reason why, at that time, that was probably 10 years ago, when we got the surface mount capability, that was one of the leading products to do. As time went on, obviously we went to those analyzers. Right here, what we're working on today on this line is the 200 watt deluxe model. This is a 200 watt PEP sideband tuner in the palm of my hand. Well, this one's actually the palm of my hand. This was the original product that Mr. Jew came up with. It's the tiny travel tuner. Mm-hmm. And then this is the kind of the after effect. We always offer something, like you say, $10 up, $20 up, $30 up. This one is $89.95. This one goes to $139.95. So with the extra money, you get a meter, you get a balun, and you get a larger tuner. All right, this is the wave solder room. I'll show you what we had to go to a no lead solder. Our previous machine was an old dinosaur looking thing. It was really big and everything was wide open. There was no top to prevent anybody from getting burned. It was pretty wild. But this is the new no lead solder bar that we use. So when he wants to melt this solder, he would just stick it down in the tank and it would melt. And he's going to run us a board here. We go across a flux material on this end. You can see the soapy sudsy area. It's going to take off the dust particles of the board, but then it's also going to put a sticky residue on the bottom where the solder pad is. And then at this point, it's going to go across a preheating element. It's almost like a barbecue grill under there. It's got some iron rods.
Yeah.
And then at the top part, you'll witness that being soldered. The previous machine, it would run across there. You really had to watch the height. Of course, this one you got to too, and there is some cleanup on this one, but the other one was getting to be a lot of heavy maintenance. And you also could not pick up the jig, or you could pick up the jig right after it went off the soldering area. Now this one is actually hot to the touch.
Oops. Plain as a whistle.
Yep. That saved a lot of time right there.
Oh, no doubt, yeah. Now, what is that, gold?
Gold?
Is there some gold in the solder?
No, I think that's just some stuff you got to clean up, right? The copper that's coming out in there, or what?
Yeah, there's a thing down there that you can clean it every so often.
The old machine was real nasty. This one, it's pretty new. We've had this for about 7 months, I think. But you can see where, it's getting a little bit clean up. So it is a nasty process, but as long as you keep it going and maintain the machines, it's really helps out a lot, obviously. We would hate to solder all those connections, but we used to do that. This is where we got all of our chips and inductors and resistors, and all of our money is sitting here waiting to go out the door. Another neat thing I like to show off in here is three shelves of through-hole boards. These are all PC boards that are still hand-stuffed. And people ask us, why do you do that when you got the fancy machine next door? Well, you can't redesign everything. It costs too much money to redesign everything to go to surface mount. So a lot of these parts 5, 10 a month maybe in sales. We've already engineered it. Mm-hmm. Mr. Jew engineered it 25 years ago.
Well, as a ham, I would probably rather have the through-hole component so I could repair it myself.
Right, well, exactly. Mm-hmm. But anything for speed, obviously, we're going to surface mount it. Mm-hmm. We have a stencil for every PC board that we surface mount. Like I said, there's the 10 boards that do for the 461 code reader and the code tutor. Mm-hmm. They do that one all at once. Every surface mount board that we have has a stencil that we put on this machine. And Sandra is actually disassembling it, but you can kind of see the solder paste she's going to wipe clean here. It's a material sort of like a paste.
Yeah.
And it's going to come off of there and get squeegeed into the holes just where we want the solder paste to go.
So that's why you need the stencil.
That's why we need the stencil. After the solder paste has been squeegeed into the holes, there's a little pad of solder right in this location. Most of the boards take very little time to go through these machines. The 269 that we paid a lot of attention to out on the line and the analyzer line takes 9 minutes through this machine. And as we talked about, the big automatic tuner takes 30 minutes. It's got 500 parts that are stuffed. Yeah. This particular board probably takes a couple of seconds, actually, probably 30 or so seconds. Now, Sandra, these machines are actually already obsolete. She actually hand-stuffs some of these parts on the board by hand because we do not have an arm that will pick this part up and take it to the board. So that is a problem, but it's not a problem for her because she's busy doing it all day long. She can handle it. Now, right in here, this is the surface mount machine, and when that's running, you can see the computer is constantly changing the style, changing the little numbers that are coming up on the screen. It's telling these arms. These are little vacuum arms that come over to these reels, and the components are on the reels, picking up the parts by vacuuming up, kind of sucking them up in there, taking them to the PC board, and shooting them back down onto the solder paste. Now, if something goes wrong and it drops one, there's some parts in here that drop down into the tank that Sandra will actually clean out later, and I'll show you the toolbox that she puts them in. The red light would come on the machine, and then it would tell her, hey, we got to redo that step. So once that board is completed, Sandra will actually check it out, hand stuff these parts over here, and then she will take it to the oven after she says it's okay. So when these come off, they are a little hot to the touch, as you can feel there. But now they've been soldered, and they are silvery and shiny. All that solder paste has been soldered at that point. And all these boards are coming off. You can see they take a beating. They're not going to knock off any parts. They're sticking to it hard. Because as these boards come off, they're landing on top of each other.
So this is really just an oven here. Everything is ready, and it just needs to be heated by the time it gets to this machine.
Yeah, if we got a pizza that can survive 270 degrees, we can put it on there, too.
It looks kind of like Quiznos here. Now, this is one of the tape or one of the reels here off components.
That is a reel. That's a 1.2 K ohm resistor.
Can we show?
You can go on and on and on. This is a 5,000 pieces of part number 100S-3150, which is a quarter watt resistor. Not just on this one day, we do it all the time, all 365 days a year. Thank you. Appreciate you.
Wow. That was something, huh?
That was a lot of fun.
I'm impressed. That's quite a factory. I guess I was probably assuming that MFJ offshored a lot of their manufacturing, but it looks like they do at least most of it there, right there in Mississippi.
Yeah, there are some small items that are offshored, maybe come from China or different countries, but the majority of stuff is built right there in Starkville. Even some of the components, like you saw the roller inductors, some of the variable capacitors, they make themselves now. You know, those items are getting hard to find out on the open market. And so we're glad that they picked it up and started building those here.
Speaking of roller inductors, somebody on the chat room was wondering what a roller inductor is. So it's a teachable moment. What is a roller inductor?
Well, an inductor, of course, is just a coil. And a roller inductor, it's the coil with a little roller inside that moves around to tap various areas of that coil to get the inductance that you want. And some tuners will use a switched inductor, which might have several spots soldered onto the different coils on there, and you just switch through which one you want. But a roller inductor gives you a continuously variable inductor. You know, you just kind of roll around to the spot that you need.
There's a skill to adjusting any antenna tuner. And we don't have time to go into that skill right now, but I believe that tuning a tuner with a roller inductor is just a little bit of extra skill necessary.
Well, that's all I've ever used, so I really
so you know how.
Yeah, it makes it a little easier. When I was working in broadcast, a lot of our antenna tuning units would have roller inductors in them. Some of them had fixed inductors where there was a little clip that you would clip onto whichever turn you wanted. But with a roller inductor, you can get in between those and get the exact inductance that you need.
Yeah, the tuner that's behind me here is the MFJ 949E. And maybe you can hear just a little bit. There's a switch right in the middle for setting what the inductance is going to be. So maybe in a future show we can talk about the science and art of adjusting an antenna tuner. And I will contradict Gordon and Bob, who on an earlier show had nothing really good to say about using an antenna tuner to match an antenna, because I don't think they knew exactly how it worked.
Well,
did you hear that, Gordon? I'm sorry.
No, that's okay.
We'll talk about that on an upcoming show sometime when I'm back. If I'm ever back, because now Bob will see this and say, no, we're going to find another guest alternate backup last-minute ditch host.
Not at all.
And I'll do my own podcast.
Speaking of coming back, did you know what happened 54 years ago to this date, October 4th? 54 years ago? Sputnik! That's right. Sputnik, the first satellite in space from Russia, was sending down a signal, and they are replicating that right now on 21.060 megahertz for the 54th anniversary of the first satellite in space. And the brain thumper question of the day is, what two frequencies did that original Sputnik send CW? And send it to me, Gordo, WB6NOA at ARRL.net, and we'll see who the winner is next year. But again, Sputnik, 54 years ago today. Do you remember that when it went up?
I was pretty young, but I have a vague memory of it. And I'm going to guess 21060 was one of the frequencies. You didn't just give it away, did you?
No. 21060 is what they're using today. It was actually two non-ham frequencies harmonically related, so they didn't need a second filter in there. So, nope, not 21060. That's where it is tonight and tomorrow, as hams are sending that signal. But when Sputnik went up 54 years ago, the question for this week is, what two frequencies did it use in the shortwave spectrum?
Now, I haven't listened to 15 meters tonight. I don't know if it's open. Kind of late for 15 to be open here on the East Coast. Have either of you tuned in to hear if you can hear that? Where is it being transmitted from?
Yeah, and Julian says we've already got one person that has won the contest. You are correct, but we won't say who it is. And also today, Cape St. George Lighthouse at the Oyster Festival is going on the air for about 5 days. This comes from Emmett of Radio Waves Antenna, W0QH, saying that In Georgia, Cape St. George Lighthouse Oyster Festival ham station on the air for about 5 days throughout the weekend. So hope you can work one of the hams down there at the lighthouse.
Lighthouses are really popular special events. I guess I'm not sure what the big attraction is, although they're cool. Lighthouses are cool. We got a lot of them here in North Carolina. But something seems to attract hams and special events to lighthouses. It's a thing to do. And they're cool. So you get a lot of special events with lighthouses.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I mean, all the oysters you can eat, huh?
All right.
A shout out from contest. While we're talking about contests, remember I said I was going to give this away this week?
Oh, yeah.
It's the comprehensive
soldering
course kit. Well, we'd like for someone who's who doesn't solder or solders very little, you don't even have to be a ham to win this thing. If you're already experienced at soldering, don't enter this and let someone else have a chance at it. But the question is, and the way we're going to work this is, if you'll email your answers to hamnationcontests@gmail.com, then we'll draw from the winning entry whoever guessed it right. You know, we'll just take all the correct answers and put them in a hat and draw out our winner. And the question is, this is from a famous ham, and you don't have to necessarily be a ham to know the answer to this, though. Here's a line: don't forget to drink your Ovaltine. Now, if you can identify who wrote that or where that line came from, and just email it to hamnationcontest@gmail.com, you could be a winner. And we'll tell you next week how this came out and who actually wrote that line.
Yeah, the chat room is starting to guess already. Speaking of the chat room, a quick shout out to a brand new tech, KD2AWP. KD2AWP, congratulations on your tech. And thank your friend, KC2TCM, for making you famous here on Ham Nation. And we need to get right back to George because you've got another smoke and solder, a one-part transmitter. Did I read that right in our rundown?
That is correct. A transmitter that you can build with only one part. So let's watch that. This week on Smoke and Solder, we're going to build a CW transmitter for $1.65. It only takes one part, and that's this right here. This is an ECS 100 series clock oscillator. It's used in many computers and computer-related products. This particular one is a 4 megahertz version. That's the only one I had, and that's just barely inside the 80-meter band. Let's flip it over and look at the other side of it. Here's the ground lead. It's soldered to the case, clearly. The lead beside that is not connected. The lead below the ground, our antenna, or output lead, and the remaining lead, the plus 5 volts DC input. Our first step, of course, is to draw a schematic. So we'll put the ECS-100 right here in the center. That's our main component. And there are four posts or leads on the device. This one's not connected. This one is the ground lead. And also, it goes to the negative of our power supply, which in this case is going to be 5 volts DC from the Ham Nation power supply. This lead is the output, and that's where we'll connect our antenna. Here, we'll connect a switch that we'll use as our CW key to turn the device on and off. And this will go to our positive 5 volts. And that's all there is to making a simple CW transmitter. Since I have no idea where my CW key is, and I promised you a little smoke and solder last week, well, we're going to make at least one connection here. We're going to take a paper clip and use that for our CW key. So we'll take a small piece of wire and twist it around the paper clip and then apply a little solder to it. Then we'll screw it down to the board. And we'll also stick another wire in the other hole on the board and put a screw into that. Now we've got a CW key that we can use. It's not the best in the world, but probably good enough for my CW skills. This is a very simple little project. We're not going to commit it to solder. We'll use a piece of breadboard, which allows us to plug our components into the holes on the board. Each of these columns here are connected together so that we can plug our wires in and connect one item to the next. The row across the top here is all connected as one, and the row across the bottom is another separate bus. All the ones in the center are broken through the middle here, so we have two rows of columns there that we can plug into. Now we've got our oscillator plugged in, and down off the ground wire, I have installed a little black jumper that goes down to the bottom bus, which I'm going to use as a ground bus here. And we'll take the negative lead from our power supply. Remember the regulated Ham Nation power supply? Well, it's back. The bottom row is our negative, or our ground bus, and the top row will be our positive. I've plugged a small jumper into the row where the output of the chip is located, and we connect a test lead to there that goes to our antenna. We should probably connect a ground down here on the bottom too, but since this is so close to my receiver, I'm not going to bother with that. And there's only one part left to install, and that's our CW key. We'll connect one lead from our key to the positive voltage bus, and we'll connect the other lead into the input voltage of the oscillator module. Now there's only one thing left to do, and that's to adjust the power supply for 5 volts. Now our $1.65 transmitter is ready to go. All we have to do is tap our paperclip key here to start transmitting. Well, that was a lot of fun, but we still got some time left, so what else could we do with this transmitter? Well, we could add one more part and turn it into an AM transmitter. Back to our schematic, the first thing we need to do is disconnect the switch, and we'll replace that with an audio transformer. The secondary of the transformer will connect in series with the 5 volts supplied. Now, we will have to readjust our power supply so that we still have 5 volts at the oscillator module, as the transformer will drop the voltage a little bit. The primary of the transformer will connect to our audio source. This transformer has a secondary impedance of 8 ohms and a primary impedance of 1,000 ohms. The power supply voltage flows through the secondary of the transformer to the oscillator. Audio is fed into the primary of the transformer, and that causes it to be added and subtracted from the power supply voltage, therefore changing its amplitude and producing amplitude modulation. I've removed the CW key, so now let's install the transformer, and I'll put 2 little jumper leads here on the primary side. That will connect to an audio cable, which I'll plug into my iPhone as our audio source. On the secondary side of the transformer, we connect one side to our plus 5 volts, and the other side of the secondary will run over into the power supply input of our audio oscillator. Let's get a little modulation from the iPhone. This is W5JDX testing my cheap AM transmitter. CQ, 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 AM. This is W5JDX testing my cheap AM transmitter. Did it work? For a CW, or Morse code signal, we'll only see the one peak right here in the middle of the screen, which is the carrier. For AM, when there's no modulation, you'll only see the carrier. When you modulate the signal, then you'll begin to see sidebands appear on either side of the carrier. Today we saw just how simple CW and AM transmitters can be, and even larger transmitters are built with those same principles. Join us again next week when I have no idea what we'll be talking about.
George, you are a never-ending source of amazement and amusement. That was awesome. I did notice one thing. First of all, it was right smack on 4 megahertz, which, of course, is the band edge. So you can't operate AM there. You can't even really operate CW there. Can that thing be moved at all? Can you get it down into the band?
You cannot adjust the frequency of that oscillator. Fortunately, though, they make those in a lot of different frequencies. You can get one at 328 megahertz, which would be in the 10-meter band. You can get a color burst frequency, 3.579545 megahertz. That puts you in the 80-meter CW band. And I think that is one of the primary QRP frequencies as well. And you can find them at 14.31818 megahertz, and that puts you in the 20-meter band. And there's other frequencies within the ham bands that you can find these. You just want to check and be sure that you do pick the right frequency. Also, be warned that these things are kind of rich in harmonics. You should probably use a band pass or a low-pass filter with it just to make sure that you're not putting out garbage you don't want to. And they're not 50 ohms, so an appropriate antenna matching network would be beneficial with this. Now, I only used it, since it was on 4 megahertz, on AM, I just used it on a piece of wire here in the shack. However, just as a carrier, I put it on the air for a few minutes and drove about a mile away, and I was still picking it up off my 80-meter loop. So you could possibly, I don't know if you could work DX with it, but under the right conditions, maybe you could.
On the antenna.
Yeah. An amplifier would, probably help out on this and some filtering. It's a good little place to start. If you want to build your first transmitter, there's a simple way to do it.
Okay. 3.79545 maybe used to be in the 80-meter CW band, but I believe that's now in the phone band. And technicians, warning technicians, you cannot operate AM on 10 meters. Sideband only. If I read my regulations correctly. Gordon, can you back me up on that, or am I all wet?
No, I got to think about that. I'll check it out and give you an answer in 2 weeks, and that next week I'm not here, but I'll think about that one. I got to check another, the rules.
Another stumper. Well, speaking of next week, George, it's you and me, big guy. We're going to carry this show on our shoulders.
Yeah, they better look out, because the big guys will be gone and it'll just be us, so no telling what we'll do.
Nope, but I have good news. And the good news is you're going to be joined by Netflix. That's right. The episode tonight is brought to you by Netflix, where you can watch thousands of TV episodes and movies on your PC, your Mac, your iPad, your iPhone, and TV instantly. So you will be joined next week by Netflix, all streamed directly to you, saving you time, money, and hassle. So to learn more about Netflix, netflix.com/twit, T-W-I-T.
George, the pressure is on. A sponsored show. We're going to have to maintain the audience, because they want to see eyeballs on the screen, earballs on the earphones. So
absolutely. Julian figured out our problem. It was the fax machine that took our audio out. So the chat room, we have burned the fax machine, so you're stuck with audio for the next few episodes.
Yeah. You said you were using the fax because if you used a computer, it would screw things up. Well,
yeah, boom. Well, little did I know.
Yeah, ancient technology.
That's
all right. We have to pretty much wrap this thing up, I think. The kids from NSFW, get off the lawn. They're in a rerun, so we can't go forever, but we're not in the biggest rush. But are we going to go down on HF? Is that the plan?
Julian says 7206 on 40, and George says, what the heck, just transmit on 4 megs. No, that's not a good idea. On 20 meters, we're 14 point, we aren't sure. Also, Mike and Cecil and Joe says that they got us on D-Star, I believe 12 Charlie. We're on the WIN system, and we're on something else. Let me think about this. Yeah, we're all over. So we hope that all of you will stick around for the next hour. But look for us down there at 7206 lower sideband, and we'll be there.
And
okay,
we'll
and George,
be
next
on
week.
Echo Link. We'll also be on Echo Link.
Oh, Echo Link. Yeah, that was it.
Do you have a node number?
If you're on a computer, you can find it at N5ZNO-L. That's November 5, Zulu, November, Oscar. Or if you're dialing it in on a repeater and want the node number, that's 309022.
309022. And the number to call in Secaucus, New Jersey is Elgin 5. All right, that is cool. That is more places than we can be all at once. But so we'll spread ourselves thin and try to touch base on at least some of those places and see what we can do. Next week, it is going to be a chat room show. I've got a couple pieces of video I'm working on from some places that I've been recently that I think you'll find interesting. And Gordon, you have had an ongoing email, maybe almost a debate with some of the vendors about programming handy talkies. And your suggestion had always been, well, a vendor should at least pre-program some of the frequencies that you might use locally in a handy talkie. But I'm going to spend some time with some good concrete ideas for what you can do to program your own handy talkie. Now, we won't be able to show you how to program every individual one because they're also very different. But I'll give you the steps you need to take to figure out what you need to do, and you can work through your manual and then actually do the programming. So I think I'll have some good useful suggestions. And if we get enough time, we'll even talk a little bit about that number one topic that every new ham has: what radio should I buy? I'm not going to tell you what radio to buy, but I'm going to tell you what to think about when you're trying to figure out what radio to buy. Without a guest next week, George, it's still going to be a jam-packed show. So think about some of that stuff.
Oh, we could spend a half an hour on which radio to buy.
Oh, easy, easy. And the chat room will go nuts with suggestions. So I'm looking forward to it. Well, thanks, everybody, for watching. Gordon, good talking to you. We'll see you in a couple of weeks and enjoy the Pacificon.
We'll keep Leo company and keep him out of trouble with the thousands of hams, I'm sure, scrambling to get one of his Leo QSL cards. See you in 2 weeks.
We've missed him here on the Ham Nation show, but you guys out west will be able to see him live and in person and doing. He's going to on Sunday. I guess he's going to do the Tech Guys show for 3 hours from the Hamfest.
That is correct. The AM radio show seen by hundreds of AM stations throughout the country on Saturdays and Sundays.
Yeah, that should be awesome. And George, I will see you next week with a chat room show, and I'm sure some more smoke and solder. I didn't see too much smoke tonight. I saw a lot. Are you going to get one of those wave soldering machines? Is that in your future?
Well, there's not room for it here in the shack, or you know, I would do it. But I'd
maybe
really
a micro
like one of those. Yeah,
a microwave soldering machine. That would be cool.
I really like the robot.
We'll see you next week, too. I'd like to thank Alex and Lynn. Alex on the controls, Lynn doing our producing, Leo Laporte and the Twit Network for putting us on the air, Bob Heil for letting me sit here in the hot seat when he's out of town, Joe Walsh for our Ham Nation theme, and Cachefly for the bandwidth and Netflix for the sponsorship. I am Gary Pearce, KN4AQ. I will see you next week right here on Ham Nation. And for now, over and out. You knew I was going to say that, didn't you?
73.
And my lovely wife, Cindy, KD4ACW, has joined us in the KN4AQTH. Was that a fish that just went by?